All right, so today we're going to conclude Law of One, Raw Material, Session 101, received December 21, 1982. The entirety of this session was put into Book 5. It's a very short session. We're halfway through it. It's really about personal process, particularly of Jim and also Don. And Ra gives some very important comments about catalyst and how to help each other. We ended last time at 101.5, where we had just gone through earlier exchanges where Don was asking about the bite of an insect or a snake upon Jim that Jim came to understand is associated with anger, distortion of anger. And that's a very common kind of thing. When anger comes at us from the environment by the principle of reciprocity or the reality that so-called outer is a mirror of the so-called inner, and or so-called outer and inner are mirroring. The outer mirrors the inner. You create your own reality. whenever there's harsh anger coming at us, it's some kind of blowback, generally from anger we've put out to others in the past or in the moment. And there are people who dish out anger where we've been kindly, but we don't know our karmic inheritance. But any kind of an injury, but particularly like an insect bite or an animal attack or a human attack or any kind of aggressive incoming, inbound aggression, aggression inbound, as they say. Is generally the return phase of aggression we put out previously. And so in 101.4, Don asks about the catalyst of the bite, or understands that the insect or snake bite upon Jim as catalyst gives him an opportunity to continue polarizing on the positive path, which he does. And the degree to which, what is the source of catalyst? Well, every question has multiple answers. Every question. All realities have multiple levels of truth based on your magnification, just like you magnify with a little microscope. And you see, oh, there are many cells here floating around. Magnify further, you go intracellular, and then you say, whoa, well, look at all these intracellular entities within the membrane of this one cell. You go further, you'll see the architecture within any portion of the intracellular, environment of little things floating around, like chromosomes and ribosomes and all sorts of things. And you go further, you look at atoms and intra-atomic space and all sorts of things. It's all true. And truth is a function of consciousness magnification, the particular focus, depth and breadth of focus of consciousness is the way we determine multiple levels of truth, or the multiple levels of reality of all experience or all phenomena, basically are perceived by changing or increasing or decreasing our level of magnification of attention, of perception, deepening perception, and that's called expansion of consciousness or spiritual path. And so Don was asking about this, the mechanism is random, or the mechanism by which catalyst comes in is by higher self, or an oppositely polarized entity, like the 5D negative Orion entity that was attacking them. The multiple sources of catalyst all being useful if we distill love light from them, or meet them with increasing love light, or love wisdom. And Ra gives a very important comment at 101.4 saying the nature of catalyst, meaning all catalyst, is such that there is only one source, I mean, if you have that deepest analysis, deepest level of magnification. 4, the catalyst and experience are further attempts at specificity in dealing with the architecture of the unconscious mind of the self. And they conclude, therefore, in an incarnational experience, meaning like incarnation now, the self as creator, especially higher self, which is a sub-sub-logos, the higher self is the base from which catalyst stands to offer its service to the mind, body, or spirit. So then, you know, it's not that there's only one source, it's there's one ultimate source. There's one core source of catalyst, which is higher self. But then the source, what's the source of higher self, is obviously the logos. What's the source of the logos? Well, it's the infinite creator. That's called intelligent infinity. So, you know, anybody, any teaching can be picked apart, but also further parsed and unpacked and analyzed and magnified and discerned and discriminated into by clear analysis or effortful analysis to go deeper and deeper. And same thing with the issue of identity, right? Buddhism says anatta, no self. Advaita Vedanta talks about self with the capital S, the one self. Ra talks about the logos, beyond unity. What is the true, what, you know, the nature of identity? What are you, right? Aham vichara. What are you? Well, it depends on your answer. The answer depends on what level of magnification of the discernment we're choosing. And so there's only one ultimate source of catalyst, which is the logos, actually, that out of the logos came the position of beingness called higher self. But this source, these sources, whether it's logos or higher self or both, are associated with this reality where catalyst and experience are further attempts at specificity. What does that mean? Specificity in dealing with the architecture of the unconscious mind of the self. Well, the unconscious mind of the self means the potentiator of mind, card 2 in the tarot. It's basically all that we don't know about ourselves, or all that's hidden from the conscious mind about the self or about our beingness, which is our total identity, our total true nature, which is not just body or mind or spirit, actually. It goes to higher self and the seven-dimensional equipment we're using in the octave, so it goes deep, deep, deep. Attempts at specificity. It's actually... how to read this statement? You can say that the very positions of 3 and 4 in the 7 links of body of mind, body, spirit in the tarot, with the positions 3 and 4 being catalyst and experience, are not of the original 3. The original 3 is matrix, potentiator, and significator. So 1, 2, and 5 is authentic or is original. Out of that 1, 2, 5 came 1, 2, then 3, 4, and 6, 7, and that's how 3 goes to 7, right? 1, 2, 5 goes to 1 through 7. So a triadism or trinity becomes the sevenfold, you know, octave, right? Okay, so you can say in that sense that positions 3 and 4, or what we experience or what we encounter that we determine intellectually with our dualistic ignorance-based mind to be catalyst and experience, or a distinction between the two, that distinction between a catalyst and experience we're perceiving a catalyst and we're responding to it, making experience, that is a further specification of the unconscious mind. And so positions 3 and 4 came out of, in many ways, position 2, potentiator of mind. So this is super esoteric, but for people who love the tarot, you can understand that the original 2, the original 3 cards of 1, 2, 5, became 1 through 7 by a further specification or differentiation of card 2, which is the potentiator of mind, the architecture of the unconscious mind, particularly the potentiator or that which is not known yet. And the purpose of catalyst is to know yourself. The purpose of life, know thyself, right? The Delphic Oracle, know thyself. And so as higher self established the 7 positions of each cycle of mind, body, spirit that we call the first 21 cards of the tarot, the higher self established that. It's the higher self that actually then provides the experience of catalyst, the experience of positions 3 and 4 provided by the higher self, which differentiated the unconscious or potentiator of mind into those 2 further positions of 3 and 4. So if you really don't understand these things, this kind of analysis is necessary, it seems to me. You know, it's not pedantic, or hopefully you don't feel so, but in that way, yeah, sure, since higher self brought the 3 to the 7 and elaborated or differentiated position 2 potentiator into 3 and 4, catalyst and experience, and then higher self is the source. However, that's easily misunderstood. And we see an example of this, I believe, in 101.5, where we start. Don says, something occurred to me. I'm going to make a guess that my illness over the past week was a function of some action by my higher self to eliminate the possibility of a residence in the proximity of the large number of bees that I observed. Would Ra comment on my statement? Meaning, Ra is just talking about really the metaphysics of our experience of catalyst being originated by higher self that differentiated, made that further specificity in our experience of the deep mind, the conscious mind's experience of the deep mind. That's the metaphysics of how the tarot, basically the veil in mind, brought the mind-body-spirit to the mind-body-spirit complex. And the position and the cards 1, 2, 5 became 1 through 7. And that's exactly what happened with the veil. That's becoming a mind-body-spirit complex. That shows that higher self is the source of what we're calling or what we're experiencing as catalyst, which seems to be other, right? You see, there's the otherness to catalyst. I mean, I could talk about this for another hour, but we have to finish the session. The experience of catalyst and the experience of response to catalyst, which is called experience, are both the products of dualistic ignorance-based mind. When ignorance-based mind drops duality, you know, is no longer caught by the illusion of duality, actually positions 3 and 4 fall away again. And there isn't the unconscious, or the veil between conscious and unconscious is so thin or well removed that we're no longer perceiving what seems to be other coming at us or up in the mind-body as catalyst. And that's what Ross said. The crystallized healer has no will. It means that there's no more choosing how to respond to so-called catalyst. And that's very high-level awakening, actually. That's non-duality. But when Ra is saying that higher self, in as the source of the architecture of the deep mind, generating positions 3 and 4, catalyst and experience, higher self is the source of higher self. Higher self is the source of catalyst. Don, like most people do, said, "Okay, well, so you mean my higher self did some action to eliminate the possibility of a residency, meaning a beehive? Oh, higher self was helping me get rid of this beehive, right? Because you said higher self is the source of catalyst, right? No, actually. And if you look at Ra's answer, they're very delicate, you know. Ra is delicate in ways that some of us teaching, speaking here won't be, because actually there are certain laws that they're in play that for interdimensional communication that are not for intra or same dimensional communication, like me to you, you to me. But actually, this perspective of Don, and I, for people who are in a hurry to the answer, you can please take a break, but Don's question exposes what I think is a very common misconception that spiritually minded people have, which is that higher self is really very hands-on in my personal life. In my experience, that ain't the case at all. And the higher the more evolved our being, meaning the more clear we are in the lower triad, and the more we're working from green, blue, indigo, the less higher self is involved. Not the more, the less. And so this notion that there was some action by my higher self to eliminate the possibility of a residence, meaning a beehive that I observed, that is a fantasy. And Ra said, we can comment not upon the questioner's physical distortions, meaning his physical body or something, or his physical symptomology, if there's any, but upon the indubitable truth of second-density hive creatures, that is, that a hive mentality as a whole can be influenced by one strong metaphysical impulse. Both the instrument and the scribe, meaning Don and Jim, have the capacity for great distortions towards non-viability, meaning death, given such an attack by a great number of the stinging insects. Now, is that Ra saying, yes, your higher self removed the beehive or removed the possibility of you getting stung? I don't think so. I guess it's possible, but I don't think so. Ra seems to skirt the answer, skirt the question, and go off to the side. And even 1016, Don asks, are the thought form parameters and other general parameters of the 893 Oakdale Road address in Atlanta such that no cleansing would be necessary? If Ra has this information, Ra said no. Meaning, does Ra have this information? No. Or can Ra comment? No. Or no cleansing is necessary? No. It's hard to say what Ra means, and Don didn't know and pushed it further to 1017, and I'll get to that in a moment. But this exchange of 101.5 I think is really important, frankly. Number one, higher self is less involved in your life than you may think. And there are a lot of people who, in what seems a manifestation of a significant love over wisdom bias, meaning I want good feeling more than I want truth. In the choice between bitter truth and a comfortable illusion, I'll choose the latter. Comfortably numb, I want comfort. And if it feels good, do it. Follow your bliss. Well, that's such a silly teaching, because bliss, first of all, is unfollowable. Okay? Bliss is non-motivational. Bliss is amotivational. If you've ever really had bliss, you can't move. Bliss is way above joy. There's no there's no experience of separate selfhood in bliss. So you can't follow bliss. It's not leading. It's non-motivational. It's non-dual. So you can't follow bliss. Meanwhile, you know, people say, like we talked about before, do whatever makes you happy. How happy are you? I mean, are we like walking around happy? We're not. Doesn't mean we're miserable. But I mean, you know, if you haven't learned anicca anatta dukkha, everything is impermanent. Everything is continually fluxing. The mind states are always changing and decaying and disappearing. You can't stay happy and you can't follow bliss. But you can be honest about how you're feeling. And if you're not well, or when we're not well, we can discover why we're not well and be willing to feel pain and love ourselves and understand and take responsibility and bring forgiveness in. But higher self is not is really not available as much as some people hope it is. And same thing with the angels. And angels, follow your angel, tell me, angel card, what to do today, tomorrow, the next day. I've seen some people become so distorted by dependency on oracular sources, oracles, like tarot and I Ching and higher self or channeling. I've seen people become psychotic, actually, over time by an emotional dependency on non-physical sources or entities or divination sources. And this very much comes from unmet dependency needs in childhood and an unwillingness to stand alone and grieve the fact that there is nobody here to take care of us fully as much as we want. No, sorry, there isn't. Now, we may find a wonderful partner and friends, but that's not easy, and that's more like a stroke of fortune and fate that demands or requires a certain merit, you know. If we have a lot of bad relationship karma, a perfect soulmate who's loving and supportive continually doesn't just appear. So people have so many distortions and pet cherished illusions and fantasies. People really prefer comfort to truth. Meanwhile, the truth will set you free, and comfort is fleeting. Comfort is fleeting, but the mind that rests in truth but seeks deeper and more broad and encompassing, expanded awareness of truth does become increasingly free. Yeah. And that freedom is real wellness, better than happiness, by the way. And so Ra's simple point is that hive mentality, like second density creatures that are in a hive, like bees and wasps, can be influenced by one strong metaphysical impulse. That doesn't say that higher self intervened. It doesn't really explain how or what happened in terms of this residence in the proximity of bees that he discovered. Yes, it is. I mean, I found wasps in my room in Taiwan extremely receptive to telepathy and extremely cooperative. He doesn't really want to stay in my room, and a 2-inch brown wasp is not what I want in my room either. So I communicate to him that I understand the situation. I'm going to help him get out and find the closest window, open the screen, get a broom, and gently speak to him as I guide him to the open window with the broom. And out he goes, and sometimes they do a little thanks dance in front of me and leave. So it's also true, for anybody who wants to think about it, that the animalization of humanity that's part of the New World Order activities is to help bring humanity to hive mentality that can be controlled by a potent singular influence, such as trauma-based mind control, such as 911, such as various traumatic catalyst or fear-based catalyst, fear-generating catalyst, from which the mass of humanity reacts in a singular way. They're trying to hive mentalize humanity as well, and that's a real problem. So it goes on and on. 1017 details about the next residence. Don asks, would cleansing of the nature suggested for the other house just south of the airport in Atlanta be advisable for the 893 Oakdale Road address? And Ra gives a good explanation about magical cleansing. They say, we note that any residence, whether previously benign, as is the one of which you speak, or previously of malignant character, such as that other one, needs the basic cleansing of the salt, water, and broom. The benign nature of the aforementioned domicile is such that the cleansing could be done in two portions, that is, no egress or entrance through any but one opening for the one cleansing, then egress and entrance from all other places while the remaining portal is properly sealed. The placing of salt may be done at the place which is not being sealed the first of the cleansings, and the salt may be requested, asking the salt, to act as seal and yet allow the passage of gentle spirits such as yourselves. We suggest that you speak to this substance, meaning talk to the salt, and name each entity for which permission is needed in order to pass. Let no person pass without permission being asked of the salt. This is the case in the residence of which you speak. It ain't the physical salt. The salt is a body, is a form, a material form that is associated with certain entities. And alchemists knew that very well. So if you want to know the spirit, the personality or character of the entities associated with salt, go to your alchemical books, about 500 years old, and look at dissolutio, dissolving. Look at the function of salt and basically, you know, what is salt? NaCl. So there's sodium and calcium. So sodium chloride. What is salt? That is salt. Look at the alchemical write-up of sodium and chlorine. The function is dissolutional, dissolutionary, dissolving, solutio, and that's a very important matter. So there are certain entities that are associated with salt that can be allies. And so Ra is teaching a very rigorous white magical methodology of working with salt for cleansing and purification. Doing it in two portions, since that place is benign, meaning there wasn't negative activity, service to self type activity going on to any great degree. There were not some kind of, like the other place was a drug haven. This is a different matter. And so I think what they're saying is first you seal the inner and the outer doors or ingress outgress, meaning doorways or windows that are around the walls of the house or lead to from inner into in the house to out of the house. Then do that with all passageways within the house, between the rooms of the house. And ask the salt to act as a seal and yet allow us to come and go during the ritual. Speak to the substance. And, you know, modern dietitian nutritionists dislike of salt, right? Salt is like an enemy. So salt is classified in the same place as white sugar, white flour, which it isn't. Salt is critical to many functions of the body, many. Nervous system and kidney excretion, obviously water balances, and neural function and muscular function and brain function too. And the low salt diet is quite harmful for many people. And just like the low fat. So low salt, low fat, low protein generally equals low vitality and low health and low mental capacity, low brain function, in my opinion. So do whatever you like, but be careful about modern experts. It's generally an oxymoron. Modern experts generally are not experts weighing in on ageless matters, like if they're contradicting certain traditions, like the importance of salt or oil and protein for building tissue. Be careful. But you got to figure it out yourself. So anyway, this was just a specific discussion about how to work with salt and make a good relationship with the salt, the entities and spirits of working that work through salt or are associated with it, to help clear a place, to seal and then dissolve and purify. 1018, getting close to the end. Don says, thank you. And this is a very important answer here that I'm going to spend a bit of time on. 1018, Don says, could Ra give information on any way that we could give information to Greta Woodrue as to how to alleviate her present condition of swelling? So she must have been a friend or a healer that they knew. Ra said, we may only suggest that the honor of propinquity to light carries with it the law of responsibility. The duty to refrain from contumely, discord, and all things which, when unresolved within, make way for workings, lies before the instrument of which you speak. This entity may, if it is desired by the scribe, share our comments upon the working of the latter entity. Meaning, well, you know, you may, or she may, if Jim is okay with it, share our comments upon Ra's comments about her process. And then is a critical comment here, ending 1018, Ra said, or somehow in brackets, the entity which is given constant and unremitting approval by those surrounding it suffers from the loss of the mirroring effect of those which reflect truthfully rather than unquestioningly. This is not a suggestion to reinstate judgment, but merely a suggestion for all those supporting instruments, that is, support, be harmonious, share in love, joy, and thanksgiving, but find truth or find love within truth. For each instrument benefits from this support more than from the total admiration, which overcomes discrimination. This is critical teaching. Two major principles here in this answer. One is law of responsibility and this honor or duty honor of propinquity to light, meaning nearness, proximity to light. Nearness to light, proximity to light means working as a light worker or working in a steady way with love and truth, love, wisdom, which means a person whose work in the world is formally of helping, has some propinquity to light, as well as obviously an adept or a person doing meditation, doing spiritual practice of any sort, doing spiritual study, trying to help others in any way, actually, over time, will generate greater or is of propinquity, proximity to light. Light with a capital L, meaning love, light, intelligent energy, the direct expression of God or the Logos. So, for those of us who are studying and practicing and teaching or talking and trying to help in a spiritual way, which is basically of mind, body, spirit, not spirit only. It's spiritual work is mind, body, spirit work, while mental work is body, mind work, and physical work is physical only. So there is, accumulation or incorporation of the lower levels. Spiritual work and helping is body, mind, spirit helping in an integrated way, which includes, you know, psychological self-understanding. So, for those who are committed to some degree of spiritual integrative help to self and other, increasingly there is propinquity to light that accords, that is, can be sensed as an honor, but there's a duty. The duty is associated with what's called the law of responsibility. What is the duty? It's to refrain from disharmony, to basically restrain one's mouth, and particularly mouth. You know, you I don't think restraining your mind is a good thing, but using the mind well means increasingly leads us to be free from triggering or emotional outburst and mental conflict. You know, I mean, we really need to be to you know, when we get upset, it's not a good thing, you know. And so it's very important to look at oneself in the mirror clearly and realize, if I'm not well, I'm not well, I did it. No matter what the other one is or isn't, I don't want to be unwell. I don't want to be in this massive enraged state. And so it's about time, I think, that we move out of our habits of aggression and self-pity. So this propinquity to light of anyone who cares about unified mind-body-spirit development and service, the duty is associated with avoiding or not getting stuck in. It's not really stopping. It's not getting stuck in when they arise, all things that, when continued to be unresolved — unresolved means unhealed, means unmet with love wisdom, unprocessed by adequate love wisdom — avoiding getting stuck in all those things that keep us from continuing on the path that are all of depolarization. So this Greta lady had some body swelling. What was that? Well, it sounds like it was associated with inability temporarily for her to avoid conflict or contumely and unresolved psychological process, emotional conflict. She hadn't gotten through her stuff enough to not get stuck, or she did get stuck in aggression, conflict, contumely, discord, and didn't heal herself or heal mind deeply enough to avoid the consequences of being stuck in anger, such as the swelling, which is associated with water gain, like Jim had too. And you know, when there's a symptomology like swelling or infection or inflammation, we definitely can trace it back to the distortion complex, the causative distortion complex, and that's very helpful. But any one symptom shared by two people or similar symptoms may have quite different causes. But knowing that helps us be free from that body illness in the future and requires us to take responsibility for our mental state and acknowledge when we're really off base or stuck in aggression. It's not a problem to feel it, but it's important to acknowledge when we're stuck and to seek to let the storm pass rather than curse it and stay in it. The final principle here of 101.8 is also very important, and there is some discussion. In fact, there's only, by the way, two other mentions in the entire Law of One series of the Law of Responsibility. And one was in session 22, and the other one was in session 60. And really, it's associated with metaphysical consequence, metaphysical principles that are associated with obligation. Basically, the intrinsic metaphysical obligations that come from doing spiritual work, positive or negative, polarizing positive or polarizing negative, which invokes the law of squares, which means polarizing positive or negative is self-empowering or self-strengthening. There's a doubling effect, compounding, factorializing, compounding effect, consequence of polarized activity or polarization. That brings with it a metaphysical principle associated with responsibility. The logos adds to our polarized efforts by the law of squares, and what's required of us is called the law of responsibility, or is associated with that other law, which is being in a system in which grace is given, being in an octave of soul evolution in which polarized activity is self-empowering, compounding, self-intensifying over time as a feature of the octave. What's then expected from us, what comes naturally, is a certain kind of metaphysical responsibility. And that Ra talked about as when we take a training aid, such as sitting in a pyramid or using crystals, using a source like the tarot even, invoking outside or supplementary assistance like a pyramid or a crystal or a sacred space, going to meditate in the cave, going on the holy pilgrimage to holy sites. In a way, we're asking for grace or accelerated evolution by way of those external conditions or objects or a location. That then entails, there will then be something given and received, and we may be intensified on our path or strengthened in our positive polarization. What then comes with that is a certain metaphysical responsibility. And that then means that, as I've said before, the vehicle is driving faster. There's an increased voltage intensity of energy as the natural result of doing spiritual work, whether it's magic, white magic, or black, or using training aids like crystal or pyramid or tarot cards or going to a sacred space. There is doubling, there is intensification then also of polarization, and therefore greater obligation entailed by what we've accepted, by what we've been given and received and has helped us. And so it's more dangerous to screw up or to get stuck in distortion as we become more evolved. The greater the sinner, the greater the saint. And the greater the saint, the greater the fall in when the saint does sin. And sin is simply just distortion, which is just basically grasping, aversion, and ignorance. So that's the first paragraph. And the second one is even more relevant for us in this love over wisdom, touchy-feely, New Age, subjectivist, effeminized culture, which is effeminized. I mean, I'm not against feminine, but there is a difference between yin and yang, you know, and to yin the yang, or to feminize the masculine, or to put water on the fire isn't helpful. There's water, there's fire. Let's have a balance between water and fire, but not confuse them and blur the fact that really they are opposite and complementary, and feminine is beautiful and masculine is helpful. And but the feminization of mind, which is part of the war on reason, and the effeminization of civilization, which is not natural, because fourth chakra, surely, and fourth density coming, is surely more associated with feminine than masculine? Yes. But there's nothing feminine about love. The logos is love, and the logos is not female, nor male. And so there's a real truth here. I mean, there's some important stuff. And so Ra is talking against constant and unremitting approval. Ra is talking against the value of service where love is way over emphasized over wisdom, discernment. The entity, any entity given constant and unremitting approval, yes, that's good, yes, I love you, yes, that's good, yes, I love you, yes, you're good, yes, I know how you feel, Yes, you're right, or yes, I feel what you feel. Oh, yes, that's bad. Oh, yes, that's good. That is not helpful. That is actually a very weak way of helping in the long run. Constant, unremitting approval by those surrounding us leads us to suffer from loss of mirroring effect. We're not mirrored. We're basically just continually comforted. The mirroring effect comes when we reflect truthfully rather than unquestioningly. Questioning is okay. Oh, the intellect is okay, you know. The intellect is not the problem. lack of love and wisdom is the problem. And so there's no mirroring. We don't see ourselves more clearly when people around us are not reflecting truthfully or speaking truth to us. If they see us in distortion, making trouble for ourselves with wrong view, like blaming and complaining, it's all his fault, he's so bad, it's so unfair, I didn't do it, I had nothing to do with it, life is a jip, God is a fake. If there, you know, there's no God, because if there's God, there'd be no evil, there'd be no injustice, there'd be no suffering. Oh, really? Why, you know God so well? You know that that's the case? If there's a God, there'd be no evil, suffering, injustice, pain, and all that? Really? You know that? You think you know, don't you? So, people think they know a whole lot more than they do. And that's because they haven't had adequate mirroring from people around reflecting back to them truthfully. And most people don't even know how to do that. So Ra's saying, we're not suggesting you become judgmental. We're making a suggestion. A suggestion of what? Reflect truthfully. And they'll explain that further. So this is a pith teaching on the blend or balance of love, which is unconditional support, yes indeed, and approval, which says yes, 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 yes. That's what love says. Love only says yes. Yes, I love you, I care. Yes, yes. However, sometimes you need to say no, you know, and sometimes yes is not helpful. If you just say yes all the time, you're going to walk into walls or make trouble and get into trouble. And so wisdom says, whoa, let me check it out just a moment. Let me discern. And so number one, the basis is love of in terms of how to support and help. Support, be harmonious, share in love, joy and thanksgiving. And even that, you see, needs unpacking. Be harmonious. Okay, I'll be harmonious. It doesn't, you know, you can't just be harmonious. You can't just be in love and joy and thanksgiving. You cannot. You can seek love and joy and thanksgiving, yes. But you can't just snap your fingers and be in harmony, love, joy, and thanksgiving. But those that have inadequate wisdom or don't like discrimination, they don't like discrimination. It's a bad word, discrimination, but it isn't. If we really look at it, which we will in a minute, discrimination is discernment. Discernment is critical. There's not much wisdom without discernment. And discernment requires effort. And it's much more difficult, indeed, than unconditional approval, loving, yes, yes, yes. But only the people with, you know, the people who don't really put effort into discrimination or discernment. Discrimination doesn't only mean judgment. You're bad, I'm good. That's not the only form of discrimination. And it ain't no accident that this word discrimination, which really means discernment, actually has been given a bad rap. Just like control has been given a good rap or rep, right? In control, he's in control. He's out of control. So control is good and discrimination is bad. Uh-huh. And so control is the opposite of love, by the way. It isn't good. And one can be completely well out of control and completely orderly, ordered naturally by love wisdom. ordered by living in truth. That comes from deep value of love and wisdom, both, not either, both together. One can be very well and orderly, not in a controlled way, but in a way of, you know, not getting into trouble, not making trouble. And I think we're all trying to learn that without control. And meanwhile, people think you got to be in control, and being out of control is some kind of frenzy, which it isn't necessarily. Meanwhile, discrimination is called racism, sexism. You know, you're a hater, you're a bad. You're bad, Ron Burgundy, as the little girl said. So, meanwhile, discrimination really means discernment, and it's critical to wisdom. And wisdom is critical to growing up and helping yourself and experiencing more of the freedom that comes with truth. The truth setting us free, the freedom of living in truth, loving truth, doesn't happen without discrimination or discernment. And so Ra's saying, yeah, sure, support, and I would say seek to be in harmony, seek to share in love, joy, and thanksgiving, but, and this is now the Blu-ray, find love within truth. Find truth within love. Find love within truth. This is a totally biased teaching because Carla and everybody here, they're all talking about love. Meanwhile, yes, we get in trouble because we live with inadequate love. Yes. However, Ra's dangling the carrot saying, I know you love love. You value love so highly. Well, try finding love within truth. The other way is to find truth within love. For those of us who are sensitive to an appeal to reality, the discernment of reality, you can find truth within love, which really means you may find that it's essential to be loving. Yes, there is a critical basis, essential basis to of reality, knowing reality and living in truth by being loving. And that's the necessity of love, the necessary dependence of wisdom upon love. Just as there's a necessary dependence upon wisdom for the further development of love. So people who don't find love within truth think that truth is dangerous or discriminatory. Well, you know, that's why people have become so stupid, frankly. So many people are so sponge-minded, because there's some sense that love feels good, but discrimination, discernment, accurate differentiation is the root of a lot of problems, or is intrinsically unloving, unspiritual, which it's not. Now, and Ra said, each instrument, find love within truth. So you people who love love so much and want this happy feeling of love all the time, thinking you can stay in love, joy, thanksgiving, which you cannot. They're all transient. It's anicca anatta, you know. It's impermanent and insubstantial. They're fine, they're great, but they're not. You can't dwell in the impermanent. You can't maintain and hold and keep and grasp and keep from losing states of mind like love, joy, thanksgiving. They're all coming and going. But if you really want all that, see where there's love in clarity, which is called truth. What we call truth is clear perception, clear conceptualization of what is. And Ra tops that by saying, for each instrument, meaning each of you, which really means everyone, benefits from this support, meaning the support of being reflected truthfully, being told when we're distorted, when we're mistaken, or when I think you're off base. We benefit from this support more than from total admiration, meaning unconditional, I like you, you're good, Yes, oh yes, oh yes. I meet so many people, even Law of One folks, many, who basically still don't appreciate discernment. Then there are others who don't know love. So there are people who are stuck, you know, it's very hard to not be stuck in love of a wisdom. What to me is a weak-minded or poorly unclear, fuzzy-mindedness. The fuzzy-mindedness of seeking to be loving in total admiration, unremitting approval continually. It isn't mature. It's immature. And so there are some people in that position. And there are others who've rejected that, and are not very nice people. They speak harshly, and they don't really, they can't appreciate beautiful flowers, you know, and the beautiful clouds in the sky, and their heart is dry and withered a bit, and that's not pleasant, and I don't like that either. I wouldn't want to hang with those people. So, both. And so, the love of a wisdom stance is total admiration that overcomes discrimination. So, what is discrimination? Well, Mr. Wiktionary says, discernment comes from the Latin discerno. Discerno means to set apart, differentiate, or decide. And discerno and men, discernomen, discernment, and men is a noun forming suffix. This discerno is the point. So the Latin discerno, set apart. So gaining wisdom requires setting things apart, differentiating and deciding. You see, the total admiration, the love of a wisdom crew that considers constant and unremitting approval, total admiration, as the only safe way of being, are afraid to decide. They're basically banking on a default mode. I will seek to be in unconditional approval, admiration, support, no matter how I feel, no matter what I see, because that's the highest way. They are afraid to decide what is and what isn't, what's helpful and what's not, what's to one's own long-term welfare and benefit and not. And as Gautama said, the karmic root of discernment, yeah, Gautama talked about it, is long-term habit and practice of going to the wise and worthy, meaning people who are wiser than we and more virtuous than we, for understanding or teaching on what's to my long-term welfare and benefit and what isn't. So there's short-term benefit, there's long-term benefit, there's deep benefit, there's shallow benefit, and there's benefit and harm. And there are people who are more wise than us, and there are people who are more virtuous and meritorious or worthy than us, who purified their selfishness more than we have. And to even perceive any of that, one needs discerno, to set apart, to differentiate, to decide. And discerno comes from discerno, dis, from the Latin, from Wiktionary again. Dis, D-I-S, the meaning is asunder, to pull apart. It's really to the condition of being asunder, in pieces, apart, or in two. The partitioning or sundering. The partitioning cerno. This cerno. Cerno is from sea. S-E-E. And cerno actually the verb discerno from Latin means I separate, I set apart, I divide, I part, I distinguish, I determine, I settle, I accept, or I omit. In fact, these are all verb meanings for discerno. Verb, you know, the act of discerno, the act of discernoing, includes separating, setting apart, dividing. This is not that. This is deep green and this is light green. This is a distortion that's very unhelpful. This is a distortion that's not so unhelpful. It's, you know, one hurts a lot, one hurts a little. This comes from this distortion arising, comes primarily from this cause and secondarily from that cause. This physical illness signifies a certain chakra blockage and a certain pattern of mind that relates to certain dynamics in childhood, that relates to the need for, you know, programming the catalyst of having the family I had, which comes from past life, you know, attachment to certain forms of desire and aggression. And that's just a shallow analysis, yeah, and it goes further than that. Discern, though, to see and discern in a partitioned way. And that's a whole lot different than total unremitting approval. And the word center, no, again, comes from separate or sift, to distinguish, to discern, to see. I sift into greater and lesser. I distinguish the relative qualities of distinct combined elements. I distinguish elements and portions. I apportion to weight properly and see the differentiated way. This is Blu-ray. And those who don't want Blu-ray, go right ahead. But it's going to catch you in the end. So this is a very important response, 101.8, that deserves a lot of contemplation. Finally, 101.9, Don says thank you and says, I see that the 45-minute timer window has passed, so I'll ask if there's anything we can do to make the instrument more comfortable or improve the contact. Ross said, we find that this instrument has used all the transferred energy and has been speaking using its vital energy reserve. We do suggest using the transferred sexual energy to the total exclusion of vital reserves if possible, meaning Ross suggesting don't go beyond the transferred energy, physical energy that she has from the sexual practice. Don't expend vital energy, or vital reserves. They conclude the alignments are as they must be for all to continue well. We are grateful for the conscientiousness of the support group. I am Ra. I leave this group glorying in the love and in the light of the one infinite creator. Go forth rejoicing, therefore, in the power and in the peace of the creator, Adonai. And that closes session 101. Next time, we're in 102. And 102 is completely taken from book 5. It's a long session of 22 exchanges, much about Don, Carla, Jim, and maintenance of the contact, meaning their own well-being. Very interesting material. It'll take us a couple of weeks to read it through. And I hope it's been helpful. So it's really quite useful to examine the personal material that was put to Book 5 because Ra continues to bring forth metaphysical principles of service, of balance, of the formation of the archetypes and catalyst. Pretty deep stuff. So just to say and give y'all some plaudits and credits, there are not many people who have spent much time in sessions 100 in the three-digit sessions of the raw material. Not a lot of people have spent much time in the three-digit portion of 100 to 106 of the raw material. And so, congratulations, and give yourself some credit for the effort you're making, which bears fruit more and more and more, for sure. So, till next time, please take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.